Hi everyone, and welcome to the SaaS Explorer Super Demo, Optimize Every Interaction with Customer Intelligence 360. I'm Craig Kestisher, a systems engineer at SaaS. Today, I'm going to show you Customer Intelligence 360, SaaS's solution for planning, designing, analyzing, and optimizing the customer journey across channels. The first part of this demo is going to take place from the customer's experience, and I'll simultaneously highlight the data streaming capabilities. Part two will be of interest to a data engineer or analyst, because I'm going to highlight our first-party data asset inside Snowflake. And then the last section will be from a marketer's perspective inside Customer Intelligence 360, so how to create segments and the customer journey. Let's get to the demo. Now, I currently have our demo website and the streaming report open. First-party data is both collected and loaded into the application in real time. We're utilizing our single codeless tag, which enables event and behavioral data collection for every session, for both identified and anonymous visitors. Different levels of data can be captured as well, for example, categories to product use. Every event is captured and added to the customer profile. First, I'm going to view products on the web, followed by mobile app interactions, and we're going to see all this behavior captured and associated to me. Now, as I'm clicking to the website, I want to make note that you're going to see personalization occur here. Now, as you know, there are countless ways a customer journey can take shape. I'm going to jump across different product lines. As you can see on this left-hand side, all these products that are being viewed are being funneled through, so creating this real-time data footprint. Now, on the website, you may have noticed the content being changed. So by having this digital behavior, I viewed the savings page, I viewed the loan page, for example, this triggered personalization on the website in this top homepage hero location. So this is just an example of behavioral driven personalization. We also have analytically driven personalization. For example, we have a product recommender. We have A/B tests with segment discovery, multivariate testing, as well as analytical targeting. These are just some of the features to optimize the customer experience, all in real time. I'm going to navigate back to the loans page and click Apply Now. This is going to be registered as a key action, which are fully customizable. Could be a purchase, cart abandonment, going down a quote funnel, and so on. Now, in this form, I already have my information plugged in, and I'm going to hit Submit. This is sending all my information down to Intelligent Decisioning, SaaS's decision engine. It delivers relevant, interactive, real-time decisions based on business rules and sophisticated analytics at scale to a limitless number of use cases. From a customer's perspective, I simply submitted a form and I received an offer. Also, to make note, based off the parameters I provided, in the bottom left-hand corner of the report, I am now part of a high-value loan journey. Now I'm going to navigate back to the investments page and submit one more form. Now, the submission of this form is going to trigger a cross-channel customer experience. In this example, it's initiating an SMS message. However, this could have been a WhatsApp message, or I could have been added to a Facebook custom audience. The journey is fully customizable to meet the marketer as well as the customer's needs. This is driving value for both the customer because they have a relevant experience with relevant offers, and it drives value for the business because they have higher conversion rates. All the mobile application behavior and data is captured as well. It is natively part of our first-party data asset and data model. All the data captured is once again associated to the specific user, creating a holistic customer view. Everything that's been on the web, mobile app, offline, we can tie together a full customer with our identity management capabilities. Now, by clicking in the app, in addition to having all these different products captured, when am I viewing, where am I abandoning, underneath the segment qualifications, you can see I'm part of the loan omni segment. This is triggered based off of viewing a specific product across different devices. So I viewed the loans on the website as well as the application, and here I'm going to be targeted in the future, for example. Now I'm going to transition from my mobile application into my email, and you can note I have an offer with the same content that was displayed on the website after I submitted that loan application. So imagine after a week or 2 weeks, I don't convert, I don't actually sign up. This could just be a little nudge. We capture all the raw engagement events, what personalizations have been both presented, seen by the visitor, as well as have they converted. And on the top of the report, you'll notice an identity ID, associated sessions, as well as channels. On the right portion of it, you can notice the identity graph. This is associating an individual identity to multiple different devices. So you can imagine you have a personal phone, work phone, tablet, PC. The real-time identity service uses a deterministic approach to govern how to match and prioritize identifications using any imparted information, whether that's field interactions, form submissions, a cookie data layer, or page element variable. We can also tie all the data from SAS with all offline data. Let's jump over into Snowflake. I'm currently inside the databases section of Snowflake. At the top, you can see the CI360 data, so I've expanded reporting and then tables. We can see custom events. If I scroll down, we have all our identity tables. So this is the same data that was used inside the streaming report, but it's available inside Snowflake or any other cloud database. Now at the top, we can see dashboards. So if I'm a data engineer, I can open up a quick report and understand what's the new versus returning users. You know, how many unique sessions have there been? Top pages. So just a quick look at the data. Then lastly, if I come up to worksheets, I can start to join together different data sources. So data from Customer Intelligence 360 and any other marketing data, for example. In this case, we're taking each individual customer and joining it with their nearest location. That's be the nearest location of a coffee shop and use that to send them a push notification for a free coffee next time they're in the vicinity of the coffee shop. Now onto part three, the marketer's perspective. I'm currently inside Customer Intelligence 360. When you sign on, you have your key metrics. For example, top performing emails and top performing journeys. On the left-hand side is our menu bar. These are all the capabilities of Customer Intelligence 360. So underneath planning, this is our market resource management capability. Activities is where you can orchestrate the customer journey. And then underneath segments is where you can create segments. That's just to name a few. I'm going to start off inside the segment capability. I'm going to expand on SAS Explore. Now in the center, we're looking at a segment map I created earlier. On the left are all the nodes I used to create the segment map. For example, the criteria, and or nodes. Now, I want to note that we have a hybrid architecture, so we do not require data to be duplicated or uploaded into our solution. We can access data where it's currently stored. For example, that could be within the Snowflake environment. Now, at the top, we have income qualifications, adults, and applying standard suppression rules to form a target audience. And then we go ahead and start segmenting our customers. Now, we can segment off a variety of ways, whether it's a data item, percentage, or count. Now, this forms three segments, the silver, platinum, and gold segment. Now, make note, at the bottom, they all have icons. This allows the segments to be used across the interface, so within an email task, for example, or digital personalization. One thing I want to note, you can see this top 10% model cutoff. So I expand this and I go to the sort. We included a model, sorted it by descending order, so we want to take the top 10% people who are most likely to convert. Now I'm going to transition to a customer journey. A customer journey reads from left to right, and it can start with a customer-driven action, such as a form interaction, a page view, a click, or a marketer-driven action, such as a bulk outbound email, but this very well could have been a direct mail or a bulk outbound push notification. Now, depending on the customer's actions, we can take them down their own journey. For example, if there's no conversion after 3 days, we send a follow-up email with a Facebook retargeting task. If the customer converts, we can send them a thank you and an upsell offer on the website. Now going to the top, based off of the form interaction, we initiated an A/B journey test, where 85% of people are going to get an email, and then 15% are going to get a push notification, and then a WhatsApp communication. Then we're going to tie together this with personalized offer on the web. So if I open that up, we can see there's three different offers, $50 cash back, 10% discount, and 25% off the first year. So how do we decide who receives which offer? So we can include segments as well as the customer's behavior. So if I hit this plus sign, add criteria, you can see I can select from current session attributes, customer's behavior, so custom events, similar to what initiates the customer journey, customer profile variables, for example, what segment do they fall under from the segment map, and outputs from intelligent decisioning, where decision flows and models is. Now you can see here, the $50 cash back offer are people who are sitting inside that platinum segment, as well as who have interacted with an application. If you want to add to the customer journey, you can hit the plus sign and add a task. Here's my library of tasks I've already created. And we have native tasks such as mobile tasks, whether it's in-app messaging and push notifications, as well as web tasks, whether it's multivariate testing, A/B testing, web tasks, as well as emails. Now, underneath the external system task, this is how I can decide to deliver content to other systems. Underneath the connector endpoint, I can search for Facebook, for example. Now, all tasks and customer journeys have their own insights reports available. Now, I'm going to pop open a data view. Now, in the center, we can see traffic sources and task attribution share. For example, different touch points, such as paid search, to email, to even tasks from Customer Intelligence 360. For example, a homepage hero task. I can decide to show both traffic sources and tasks, or one or the other. I can also filter different models. For example, filter out custom recent and the exclusions. In this case, I'm left with analytic, first touch, and last touch, so I can see the performance of different attribution models. As I scroll down, we have a touchpoint analysis. Now, this touchpoint results section displays the touchpoints that were allocated the most credit for the conversion by the selected model. For example, I have analytics selected. And now underneath the customer journey, this is a list of journeys that are ordered by conversion rate. So I'm going to expand on this specific journey. Here we're introduced to metric of time. So we can see between the homepage hero task and the campaign landing page task, we have the time period between a 4 minutes as opposed to 44 minutes. So we can start to understand if real-time marketing is actually as effective as we assumed it to be. Now I'm going to transition over to Plan, our market resource management tool. Now, data that powers this list view is the same data that powers our calendar view. So if you update in one location, you don't have to worry about updating in another location. You always have the most up-to-date information. I'm going to navigate to the Gantt view and adjust from quarterly to yearly. When I scroll down, I'm going to expand on the 2022 marketing plan. So we can start to see the hierarchy and everything that's going on across the entire year. I can expand into the highest level, so the plan. Underneath the Relationships tab, you can make note of the hierarchy as well. Now, this is also the first step when it comes to budgeting. So we have top-down budgeting as well as bottom-up budgeting. You can make note here on the budget amount for each of the different types, whether it's a program, to a journey, to an activity. Now, if I hit here, I can add in a program or an activity or a task into this 2022 marketing plan. If I come to the financials, we also have cost center distribution. For example, a specific cost center, the cost center name, and the budgeted amount. If I come back to the Relationships tab, I'm going to expand on the education funding journey and into the education paid advertising. Now, underneath this Details tab, we have custom metadata forms. Now, these are available at all levels of the hierarchy. Now, if I come to the workflows, I can hit Start Workflow, and I can decide on which workflow. So this is mapped to every business's standard operating procedure. So if I hit Continue on a sample, come to the summary, I can see Create Content, and I can start to associate a contributor to it. Now, this can be internal, for example, marketing, to legal for the review, or an external agency. This allows for smooth efficiency in terms of creating new marketing content and collateral. That concludes our super demo for today. If you have any questions or comments about this demonstration, you can reach out to me at the email address listed on the slide. Thank you for watching.